We're going to be studying today the life of the Welsh revivalist called Evan Roberts. He's probably one revival that both the Pentecostals and what you may call the evangelicals both agree on as one of the greatest ones in history. When I first began to read about the life of Evan Roberts and how God used him as a very young man, I was very surprised when I got to the end of the book that I was reading that the revival only lasted a few years, but his life lasted into 1951. The revival began in 1904, went to 1905, and part in 1906. But when you get over into 7 and the year of 1908, it seems to fade away. I first thought, well, maybe he passed away or something along those lines had happened. But then I realized he just left the scene. He was no longer out there preaching. He had disappeared and went into a lifetime of silent isolation, as it was called. And so that began to bother me. I thought, why did this great revivalist who led over 100,000 souls in less than a year to the Lord in the nation of Wales disappear from the scene, disappear from the church realm, disappear really from the public view for the rest of his life? So that began to cause my journalistic spirit kind of to go after what happened. And I've been spending over 10 years trying to find the rest of the story. What happened to the revivalist? Why did he disappear? And all of these great little hidden truths to bring to the forefront. When I begin to find them and come to some answers, they were not answers that I wanted to accept. They weren't answers that I was willing to accept. But it was so in black and white, and that's the way it happened. So in this series, I'm going to bring to you the story of the revival. And then I'm going to bring you the story of what I call the saddest person I'm going to talk about, the saddest story in this whole series, of the man that died in his early 70s, but only preached for a matter of a few years of his life, and lived a quiet, isolated life for the rest of his being. When God calls you, you're called for a lifetime. There is really no retirement. You might slow your pace, but the fire to preach and the fire to minister will never leave your insides. So for a man to touch a nation, to have the nation well in the palm of his hand, and then disappear for a lifetime, to me was something I wanted to discover all the reasons why this happened so we could teach yourselves and I could learn myself on how to skip over, obviously, those ditches of failure. His life began June the 8th, 1878. He was born in South Wales. His parents were of the Calvinistic type of Christian belief. He had 13 brothers and sisters. I guess in those days, I mean, what was John Wesley's family? He had 19 brothers and sisters, and John Wesley was 13. His brother Charles was 14, I believe is the way it goes. They had a lot of large families in those particular days. The family raised him on good work ethic, good morals. They taught him the Bible. Sunday school was a part of their life. Family worship at home. What we'd call in the early days of Pentecostalism in America, the family altar. They prayed together as a family is what they are saying by saying we had a family altar or we had family worship time, which I think would be a great thing to have today back in our families that instead of always watching television, take a few moments out of the week or out of the day and have a family prayer together, read the Bible together for a few moments. You'd almost think asking somebody to do that, that you're asking them to do something that is so infringing on their child's development or hindering their personal flow. But I think it would build more character, more morality, and give their children a greater stamina to survive and live right in the days that we are alive today. At the age of 12, he began working in the mines with his father. He was paid 75 cents a week. At the age of 12, can you imagine, a little 12-year-old boy went down into the coal mines and dug coal and put it into the carts that the pit ponies would pull out at the age of 12 and earned 75 cents a week to help his family support the needs of the brothers and sisters and all the needs of a family. I find that a little bit intriguing that this young man was not resistant to it and the parents weren't resistant to it. But one of the greatest stories came to him that he was known as the religious one of the workers, because every morning he would be the first one at the entrance of the coal mine, and he would be giving them scriptures or things to think about why they were down there working. And when the noon day whistle for lunch would blow, he'd be up talking to some of them about the Lord. And then at evening time, when the evening whistle would blow, when work was concluded, he'd be the first one up, not to go home, but to stand there as they came out of the coal mine to ask them, well, what do you think of that scripture day? What did you think about that? Did the Lord speak to you? Always trying to get them to think about the Lord, consider being a part of a chapel or a local church in their area, trying to bring them to the Lord even at a young age. His brother also worked down there with him. And there was a little place in the wall of the mine where they had carved out a place where he had put his Bible. Well, one day he was not at work, but there was a coal mine explosion. And the explosion began to burn part of the Bible and the edges of the Bible, and it became known as his famous scorched Bible, as later in life it would be a sought-after artifact from museums in Wales and so forth to have this scorched Bible that I think eventually was torn apart and given pages to friends and followers and believers in the revival as the revival was dismantled and given away. But it became a great symbol to the spirituality of this young man. The revival began as he got a little bit older, into his 20s, even though as he was a young man going to school, they had him mentally checked one time because they thought there was something wrong with Evan Roberts, because they would see him walk down the street and he would stop and his lips would be moving but no voice would be coming out, and he would be talking to somebody that was not there. So they thought there was something mentally wrong with him. And so Evan Roberts was told by the doctor, his parents was told that their son Evan Roberts had a religious mental fixation, that he had something within his mind that kept him on religious thought, that if he did not fix it, he could have damage to his emotion as an adult man. But I think what was happening in his life, as he was walking down the road, a young man trying to have a relationship with the Lord, that he would just stop, and whenever he'd feel, later in life he would tell us, whenever he would feel the moving of the Spirit, or felt a longing, or felt some type of wrong trying to attach itself to him, he would stop and start talking to the Lord. And that's why some of his friends, and even some of his friends' parents, would say, there's something wrong with that young man, because we'd see him on the side of the road walking home from school, or going to school, and he'd just be standing there, not moving, and just talking to the air. Well, I don't know if I would encourage everybody to do that, but I would encourage everybody to talk to the Lord. But he did the best that he knew. Thank God people do what they know, and God covers where they're weak or where they're wrong until they learn better. And they said of him that he never was a young man that dated a lot. He had some desire to play a little bit of sports, but mainly when you were in question where he was, you could always go to the local chapel, or we just call it our local church, but they're little small Welsh chapels. And they'd find him there talking to the minister, or at the altar praying, or doing some type of labor around the church for the kingdom of God. He said in his writings that he always wanted God, pursued God. There's something about a person who never went out into the world to venture into what you call sowing wild oats, or being involved in sinful things or worldly things, but he always stayed close to the church and close to the things of God. Not saying that he was perfect and he didn't make any mistakes, but his heart and his life was that way. And so they were said that he was a young man that was always around the things of God, pursued the things of God, the natural things that other young men his age and young women his age would be concerned about and talk about. He was not concerned about. When he was with his friends, the conversation always came back around, they said, to things of the Lord. Have they been to church? Have they been praying? Or what God was impressing on his heart, and what God was doing in his life? I kind of can relate to that to a little bit. When people of, 13, 14, 18, they're not concerned so much about the things of God unless they've really been touched by God. The move of the Spirit in the heart of the young, sometimes they don't know how to carry it right. They do the best they can. And if we're not careful, we discourage young men and women who God is touching, who they're responding to that touch, to make them more like other people, more like other children that play the sports or into all the dating game that goes on in the early teen years. And those things are their right. Those things are their privilege. And yes, it is normal. But sometimes I think as parents, we must be sensitive that God may be intervening. All your prayers you prayed, he may be answering. All the things that you desired that God would do with your child may be occurring. I know sometimes I get letters myself, because I was raised in a similar fashion by my mother and my grandmother, that they taught me to pray. And in my heart, I mainly pursued the things of the Lord. I like playing basketball and doing certain things, but I always preferred to be in the things of God around the church. And we had family prayer ourselves. So I knew that having a relationship with God was not just a religious routine, because I saw the fruit of my mother and my grandmother's prayers. I'd come up from school and see people in my front room talking to my mother and grandmother and thanking them for their prayers, or give them a report on the prayers they'd prayed a few months before. And since I knew their children played with them out in front in the streets or in their yards playing football or basketball or whatever we were doing, I knew by being around the homes that things had changed. So I knew that God was real, fruit came, and it was not just a routine to us, but it was a reality. And I believe that was the way Evan Roberts' life was too. The revival began with a vision and a prayer meeting, September the 29th, 1904. Evan Roberts and his friends had gone to a prayer meeting where the famous Seth Joshua had been ministering, and they said the spirit of prayer, what we call the spirit of intercession, fell upon them, and he began to pray a famous prayer, bend us, O Lord, which would mean to us, Lord, whatever it takes to get us pliable and vulnerable for you to do what you want to be done through us, go ahead and do it. We yield to you. And so they said it this way, bend us, O Lord. And during this prayer, Evan Roberts had a vision. And in this vision, he saw the nation of Wales being lifted up off the earth toward the sky and saw a hand come and touch it, which meant to him was the Spirit of God was about to do something great in his nation. And he was impressed that the Lord spoke to him and said, I'm going to give you 100,000 souls in just a short time in this year, in a short time period. And so he turned to his friend. I love this. He turned to his friend and said, do you believe the Lord can give me 100,000 souls in a few weeks, in a few months? And his friend goes, I agree, I believe. Thank God for the kind of friends that don't go, yeah, right, and discourage your faith and make you think you're nuts, but they encourage your faith. He goes, I believe too, I believe it's so. And so he felt impressed for the Lord to leave this prayer meeting where he was visiting and go back to his home church or the chapel where he and his family attended. Asked the pastor there if he could hold a special youth meeting to express what God had shared with him, what God was doing in his life, to the young people there in the church. Well, the pastor agreed and said, of course you can hold a meeting after the Sunday morning service. So it was announced and it was told about. But only a couple of little young people came, one small child, a lady or a young girl about 16, and about a few adults showed up to be at this meeting. Evan Roberts got to the pulpit and made his few comments about what God was doing and began to pray. And as he began to pray, the momentum of the revival began to take off. The feeling and the presence of God hit the people, the few that were there, and they broke and began to cry. And I don't know why that seems to be such an unusual thing. When the Spirit of God touches people, they're going to break and they're going to cry. They're going to break and they're going to have the joy of the Lord come over their soul. Something's going to happen. But they broke and began to cry and repent. So they had the meeting that night. And it began to go to the next day. And little by little, this revival that began with him just sharing what had happened to him in this prayer meeting and what was on his heart began to move. And pretty soon, the whole chapel filled up with people. And the people came and would stay to 2 to 3 o'clock in the morning. They didn't stay to 9 o'clock because they had school the next morning and they had a job the next day. It seemed all of a sudden that the natural, that they were normally confined to the schedules and the controls of their natural life, had disappeared, and they were focusing on what God was saying and doing to them, to the point where when the revival began to take off, all of a sudden, all the chapels, the little churches all over Wales begin to fill up, even without Evan Roberts being there. So the revival of Wales was not governed or controlled by Evan Roberts, but it was ignited, and he was what I would call the main leader. But the Spirit of God was moving in such a way that all over Wales, these small little Welsh chapels were moving and being filled up with people. Now, here are some things that I thought was always been humorous to me when I read about the Welsh revival. When it began, at the height of it, the movement, it hit the newspapers, of course. You can't have a move of God without reporters. It just all goes together. Some people say, well, I just want to have a touch of God without having all the fanfare and all the publicity and all that. Well, get over it. You're going to have it anyway. That's just the way it goes. When God starts doing something, the anointing attracts a crowd. The testimonies bring the other needy in. And the reporters wanting to sell newspapers or get a good rating on the TV is going to do something about it. So it just all goes together. But when this revival hit, the history books of Wales, the natural history books, not just the church history, but the history books they use in the schools and the history books you can find in the libraries of Wales, talked about this time period. The revival began like in 1904, went through 105 and 106, and began to fade through 107 and 8, and by the time we get to the latter part of 8 and 9, it's almost all gone. But here's some things that I thought was very, very funny in some things, but also interesting. When you have a revival, what we're having today is more refreshing. The Toronto is a refreshing. Some of the Rodney Howard Brown meetings is more of a refreshing. It's not so much what I would call a great revival because there's not that many souls getting saved. Yeah, some are getting saved, but it's many of the believers are coming to a life again, getting some joy to get some strength to go do what God called them to do, if they're actually going to obey it, and carry it from a refreshing to a revival. It is recorded in the history books that all the little prostitute houses that you'd find around the Welsh countryside and in some of the big cities, that when the revival was at its height, the prostitute houses where the businessmen from England and different places around Europe would come to do business at time would go visit their local friends and commit fornication and adultery and so forth. All of a sudden, revival hit these ladies, and they got saved, and they turned their prostitute houses into singing chapels, it was called in the newspapers. So in their doing business, they're in there singing. So when the men came to do their business, they got, instead of a nine in the bedroom, they got sung to by Christian ladies who once were sinner ladies, but now Christian ladies, singing songs to them and coming to go to the revival. The thing that I thought was interesting, fact that I found out about when the revival was at its fullness, was that in the coal mines, they had these what they call pit ponies, little horses that they hooked up the carts to, and they would take them down into the mine, and they'd put the coal in it, and the ponies would pull it up, and they would dump it where they were supposed to up top, and they only would move according to the coal miner's words, and the coal miners would cuss at the little pony, and the cuss word meant go, another cuss word meant stop. Well, when the revival hit, the coal miners quit cussing because they were saved now. They wouldn't use foul language. They didn't believe that was what a Christian should do, and I agree with them. A Christian should not use foul language. But they wouldn't cuss no more, to the point they wouldn't even tell the pit pony when to move, so the pit pony just stood there. And the managers and the owners of the coal mine got all mad and didn't know what to do because the ponies wouldn't move and their workers wouldn't cuss. So they had to go out and get new ponies and train them to take the cart down and take the coal up out of the mine. And I thought that was always humorous. These big coal companies was affected by the revival to the point they had to go out and buy new horses because the coal miners wouldn't cuss and the poor ponies didn't know what to do. They were being hit with sticks, and finally the owner said, let's buy some new ponies. Now, to me, that's a revival that's affecting society. It's good to have an effect of the heart, but it's also good to see how a move of God can affect even the local businesses around the communities when these revivals take off. The other thing I found interesting, the business hours of the nation of Wales changed to fit and accommodate the desire of the people. The people would come home early to get washed up and to get dressed to go to the church to be there on time, and they'd be there to 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, like I said. And so the business hours would actually close 2 to 3 hours early. Instead of 6 o'clock, they would close at 4 or 3 o'clock, so the people could get home, get their children together, because the children were taken to the revival as well, and go there, and they'd get there early so they'd get a seat. Because most of the chapels in Wales are small chapels, only seating maybe 200 or 300 at the most, maybe 500 if you call that a big one. And the rest of them, they had to open up the windows and the back doors, and people just stick their head in and try to listen that way and be a part of it in that kind of setting. So the business hours of the revival changed. I love to see California, where I live, have some business changing of hours because of the revival. I love to see New York, London, parts of Europe have the same thing. If he did it once, he could do it again. And I believe we'll see some of that. To what degree, I don't know, but I believe we'll see some of these kind of things again. Another interesting thing I found when I researched the Welsh Revival was, at the height of it, in America we have what we call the Super Bowl, where the two football teams are going to challenge each other for the winning of the great title of that they're Super Bowl winners. Well, over in Wales they have what we call in America soccer. The Europeans call it football. And they had their big tournaments every year. But the year of the revival, the year before they had the winner, the year before that was the winner, but the year when the revival was at its height, there was no tournament. And on the history books of the sports soccer leagues, it just says the word revival, and it goes the following year, who played again and who won. And right in the middle of the league of who won each year, there's the word revival, because at the height of the Welsh revival, it so stopped even the sports events, which for some people is their gospel and their Bible. And to have a true revival stop a major event like a Super Bowl like that because a revival had hit the country. Let me give you a few more. The political rallies, when they would run for office in city council and what we would call mayor, the mayor of a city, the political rallies were canceled too, because everybody went to the revival and they wouldn't go hear political speeches. They wouldn't go talk or around and find out what this candidate believed and who's going to vote for here. So finally they said there's no use to compete with the revival. So the political side of the nation had to cancel most of their rallies because no one showed up, no one wanted to vote. They were all going to church and being a part of the revival. Another thing that was interesting fact about the revival at its height, that the Bible Society said that they sold 3 times the amount of Bibles than any other time in the history of Wales, even to this day. The Bible Society could not keep them in the bookstores. They were printing them as fast as they could, and all the Bibles they could find would be out of all the stores. The library Bibles would be checked out. Everybody wanted a Bible. So I think we're having a revival. If the book, number one book in the nation, is the Bible, and they can't keep it in stock, I think we're having a good move of God. Another interesting fact about the revival was that the crime rate in the nation of Wales went so low that they began to lay off policemen because there was no need for them. I love to see that in Los Angeles. I love to see that in Orange County, where I live, about an hour south of L.A., that all of a sudden we get a headline in the newspaper, or our 6 o'clock news says local police laid off because crime has gone so low that we don't need as many policemen as we did before. That's when God begins to touch the life of a person. So many times we're trying to make laws to have morality and make laws to make people do certain things. You'll never be able to make the laws that stop abortion or stop homosexuality or stop other what you may call sins or social ills. What's going to change is when God touches the heart of a person. I don't care how many laws we pass or how many aren't passed. What we need is a move of the Spirit of God that touches the heart of man. That's the only way that these things will begin to decline, and righteousness and right living will come up the other way. And that's the way it is. So many people are trying to pray for a new president. We probably need a new president, a good president, a new governor, new mayors, good people. I believe in doing that. The Bible says pray for them that are in authority. But what we need first of all is God to touch the heart of the people. And revival is not confined just to the church walls. It may start there, but it should be carried out like it was in the Welsh revival. Another thing that was noticed in the Welsh revival, even in the history books, was that the alcoholic and the drunkenness rate in the country went down so low too that many of the saloons had to turn into singing saloons instead of serving drinks. They'd gather there for Bible study and prayer meetings and have little testimony meetings because they wouldn't drink no more. There was no need for them to try to serve Jack Daniels or some other mixed drink. They didn't want it. They were talking about the Lord. They were singing songs about the Lord. And that may be hard for some of you to believe, but it does happen. When God touches a heart and they really are vulnerable to Him, things change almost in a moment. Another interesting fact was that the banks and personal people begin to report that long-time debts that were owed to them begin to be paid. There's your place to have a discussion. When a move of God really comes, when people are being touched by God, it just won't be an emotional thing. It just won't be something they talk about or have for a few days. Their life begins to get in order, and where it's not right, they begin to fix it fast as they can. That is recorded in the history books of Wales, not just the church history, but the secular history, that people begin to pay their debts to the banks, to their companies, folks that borrowed money from their neighbors or from the family members, all of a sudden begin to pay it back in full, sometimes a little here, a little there, but they begin to pay their debts off. When people are touched by God, things begin to get in order. All of a sudden, they begin to go to their friends, too, and say, you know, I've done you wrong. I've hurt you. I've done this to you. I stole from you. And they begin to ask each other to forgive them. When you're in a move of God, we're just not laughing and rolling. We're also repenting, getting right, paying our bills, and staying away from areas of sin that we once were prone to go to and was controlled by. We need those kind of moves of God again. In the American society and part of the European society, we have people that think, well, we've got to make sure everybody feels comfortable. We've got to have a church that accommodates the lifestyle of the people. Well, in my community in Southern California, if I build a church that accommodates society, I've got to build a church that accepts homosexuality as an acceptable lifestyle. I've got to accept abortion as an acceptable lifestyle. I've got to accept that people on their fourth and fifth husband, that there's no problem there. I've got to say everything's fine. Well, that's not scripture. Fine. And even in the realm of emotion, you know that's not fine. When you have a move of God, things change. Things move. People start living better. Maybe they still make mistakes, but they start getting things out of their life. They set things in order. As I said, they pay their debts. They start leaving places where they're used to sin or that the pull of sin is on them. They start getting things right with family members, husbands, wives, children, neighbors, and all of a sudden harmony, peace, and love. The Spirit of God does that inside of you. And the Welsh Revival is one of the greatest. As historians and preachers read it and young Christians read about it, that's why the charismatic Pentecostals, the Methodists, the Episcopalians, all of them, all agree this is one of the greatest outpourings ever seen in history. But it also has a downside. I would love to be able to tell you stories during this series that never had a downside. But we have a downside in almost everything we talk about. I'm not trying to be negative, but as I told you in the beginning, I talk about I talk about the negative so that we can learn from it. Not to judge them, not to push them down, but we can learn how to jump over that ditch of failure. How to remove ourselves from some type of temptation that could cause trouble in the future. No matter how anointed we may become, how great the crowds may come to hear or to receive from what God's given you, you're still a human being. And Paul said it this way, we have this great treasure in an earthen vessel. And we always have problems with the earthen vessel. Great men and women never collapse or lose their position in the kingdom or fall morally or get involved in finances the wrong way because of their anointing. They get in trouble because of their inner life not being developed, their private life. You see, when you're under the anointing, it's like you're on a high. You're on a, say you're on a drug that gave you supernatural strength. But when that anointing lifts, when that power comes off of you, then if you don't have an inward capacity that is strong and built up by personal devotion and personal prayer time and making yourself do what is required of you to have an inner man that is strong, then you'll be overcome by the backlash that comes from what you do in the anointing, because you mainly have to do with that out of what you have on the inside. Because by the time the backlash comes from what you preach, what you do, what you say, the anointing is lifted, and you've got to deal with it with your own natural soul and your natural being. So that's why some of these great people we've studied had trouble. They quit having a prayer time. They quit paying a price privately. And they just went on riding the anointing. You cannot wing it. You've got to have a strong personal life, and you've got to be able to flow in the anointing. I would say it this way. If we're going to have a successful life and a successful ministry and be a happy person and a happy preacher, which so many times ministers are not happy, their wives are not happy, their kids are not happy, mainly because they don't spend time taking care of themselves privately, and they are addicted to that outward anointing, because when they're under it, nothing bothers them. The cares of this life do not control them. Criticism has no power to move them, but that's not the problem. It's when the outward anointing lifts, and you have to all of a sudden deal with it, what you have on the inside. And if you've not been a student of the Word, you've not been with the right types of fellowship, you've not had personal prayer time, you've not prayed and built yourself up, you've not kept the right confession, you've not kept the right mental attitude, you haven't done these things, all of a sudden, the critics of what you're doing, the religious gainsayers, the opposition, and all of these things, and even the demonic backlash that comes in the spirit realm over your soul, and sometimes to depress even your spirit if you allow it, will begin to push you down, and you'll begin to go into natural things to try to cause those feelings to disappear. You'll talk to the wrong people. Or say, for example, we'll be studying some other men later who were alcoholics, and when that pressure hit them, they went back to where they had their security before. They go back to the bottle, or they go back to sleeping around. They go back to some worldly activity. We have to build a strong inner man. We have to build a strong spirit. Evan Roberts was at the height of his revival. The Spirit of God was moving tremendously through him, and he had the nation in the palm of his hand, as one reporter said. But all of a sudden, he began to have physical collapse. He had 8 nervous breakdowns in his lifetime. The revival that he led absolutely began to take his very life from him. People say, well, how can a move of God take your life? Well, let me go back and explain a few things to you that maybe be able to help you in what God's called you to do by learning from this example. He was a man that went night and day, night and day, night and day. Never stopped, never rested. He just went. He would pray, get up and preach, travel. There's a lot of things he did right, but the few things that he didn't do right begin to take his life away from him. The first sign of the collapse, that he had, was all of a sudden he began to lose his brotherly love and the kind disposition he had when he was preaching. And all of a sudden he began to get a little bit of a harshness and a bite in his words. Because now by this time the first wave of persecution or criticism began to come from some newspaper people and from some local pastors who thought he was wrong, that he was too young, that he was developing a relationship with familiar spirits, and all these accusations. Well, what he was doing was he was also being used by God to pioneer certain things. Number one, the newspapers call him telepathic. I was reading that report, and I thought, you know what they're describing was he was flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. Now, they did not know to call them like we do today, because they didn't have the light that we have today on these gifts and how they flow and all of the things that we know. They didn't have that. So when you're studying history and the moves of God, you have to remember, understand them in the time and the light they had and the light they did not have. Sometimes we're judging them according to our standard, but that's not fair because they were not where we are and we're not where they were. And so what the problem was, the newspapers are going to say he was telepathic. What he was doing, he was coming down from the pulpit, walking down the aisles, and beginning to tell people, there's this sin that needs to be repented of. There's this pain that God wants to heal. This emotional trouble God wants to fix. And he began to tell people about the problems in their life and what God wants to do. And they'd break and they'd begin to cry. And the Spirit of God began to heal them. Well, that was a criticism that began to bother him. Then local pastors got mad. Now, the beautiful thing about Evan Roberts was that he'd come into a meeting, and he would sit on the pulpit sometimes for an hour or two and not say anything. He'd just allow the Spirit of God to move. And what would happen? This is what would happen. People would stand up and begin to sing songs of the Lord. This is what we call the song of the Lord, or little melodies that God brought up in their spirit. They would just sing it, and all of a sudden the crowd would kind of learn how the song would go, and they would sing it. And sometimes hymns would be just sung. They'd just sing for 20, 30 minutes. And the glory, they said, would come like waves of the ocean. It's interesting in my study that many generations describe the feeling of the power of God and the presence of God coming like waves of the ocean. It'd get strong, then it would lessen up and get stronger again. Then he'd sometimes get up and he would speak for a few moments. And he said he would only speak when he felt unctioned to speak. So he may only stand up and preach 5 or 10 minutes or encourage them for 5 or 10 minutes. That is why we have very few sermons to print or to read about what Evan Roberts would say, because the Welsh revival was not so much a preaching revival, even though there was preaching in it, but it was more the Spirit of God came, there's exhortations, a little encouragement, a few full-length sermons, but mainly exhortations, scripture reading, prayers, and the Spirit of God would just move over them. Well, the fourth nervous breakdown that Evan Roberts had was the worst. Evan Roberts now had taken some time off, come back a couple of times, and by this time, he got to the fourth and the worst physical collapse. He collapsed to the point that he had to be on a stretcher. He was confined to bed. And there was a woman named Jessie Penn-Lewis, who has some very good books, but also has some things that we're going to discuss here, that I believe was one of the reasons of the downfall of the Welsh revival and the ministry of Evan Roberts. She had just been excommunicated from a group of ministers that she had been ordained through because of her extreme teaching on the cross and the suffering of Christ. I think every believer and every minister believes that there is a degree of suffering in the Christian life. If Christ suffered, there's going to be some degree of suffering, persecution, and so forth that we go through. And she preached it to an extreme and would not fix it. Well, Evan Roberts was going through this mental and emotional and physical exhaustion, and he felt like it was a time to go away. And when he went away to pray, he came back believing that he must have the sufferings of Christ, and that's the only way he could really have a ministry more like Christ. Well, when Jessie Penn-Lewis heard these kind of comments and these kind of discussions, she thought, there's one of my own. So she began to come over and attend the meetings and became friends with Evan Roberts. When he had his fourth collapse, she was there, put him on a stretcher, put him on a train, and her husband took him out of the nation of Wales to the nation of England to their estate called the Woodlands Estate. It was like a country estate that they had built, and put him in the house and begin to try to recuperate him and help him rest and get things in order. And he would go through such, you know, deep depressions. Doctors would come and say that he was physically exhausted, he'd never preach again, or he would die an early death. And all these type of reports begin to go into him. Now, at first, you look at the life of Jessie Penn-Lewis and you think, such a kind woman. She's there to help this young preacher out. But the problem was she began to help him, quote unquote, understand the error of his ways. She began to tell him that many things that were happening in the revival was demonic. They eventually wrote the book called War on the Saints, which is a book that I do not recommend, but they did write it together. Mainly she wrote it, and Evan Roberts gave a little input to it, which later in his life, he asked people to forgive him for putting his name on it and releasing it because it caused so much strife and division in the revival. And she began to tell him, well, this is of the devil, and this is of the devil, that is wrong. She had so much a demon consciousness that everything that he had in the revival eventually, because of her words and influence, he believed it was all demonic and even disassociated himself with it. Here's some interesting facts, too. He never went back to Wales after the death of Jessie Penn-Lewis. He was so isolated and secluded that even when his family would come to visit him, he would not see them. And sometimes she even gives a hint that she would allow them to see him because it may affect their spirit and affect what he was doing, and really kind of downcast at his family. And the thing that I have always felt that was wrong, that she was She captured this young man and began to put into him what she wanted. And I think that this was a Jezebelic spirit that worked within this woman, because when finally he was back to physical health and mental strength, he didn't want to preach. He just wanted to pray. He wrote poetry, wrote a few things on prayer for a magazine there in Great Britain, and never went back to Wales until after she had died. Here's a point that I want to make. The story of Evan Roberts at this part of his life has this great trauma to it. When somebody has a collapse, and you're sick, and you're under, say, the weather, and you're going through trials and tribulations and emotional problems, you don't run to a stranger. You run, number one, back to your own blood and flesh, and you live with your family. You run back to your spiritual family. He should have been back to Moriah Chapel, to the people that began with him, to his pastor there, to his family, and recuperated physically and spiritually. And then he needed to allow men that have older years, that have led the revivals before them, like F.B. Meyers, G. Campbell Morgan, possibly Andrew Murray, different ones that were trying to get to him. I wanted to talk to him. He wouldn't even see these great men of God that had the stature and the fruit to say, we've lived wrong, we know what we're doing. He associated and gained, was trying to get counsel and wisdom from the wrong party. He allowed a woman whose spirit was wrong, whose message was tainted, to come into his life and begin to tell him that this is not right, this is not right. And he accepted it, and he lost his whole ministry. The man Evan Roberts only preached a few times more after the death of Jesse Penn Lewis. And they said when he got back in the pulpit, the same thing began to happen again. He was a carrier of this revival. Even though he shunned photography, even though he shunned the newspaper men, even though he didn't like publicity, it seemed like as he came back in older years to try to have a move of God again, when the reporters began to come back, that he began to go back into his emotional trauma and his physical exhaustion and never preached again, maybe a little Sunday school class at Moriah Chapel. In the latter part of his life, he would take a trip once a year to England to visit some friends. And some of his friends in Wales would see him at a sports event or going to the theater. And some of the friends thought they had backslidden and moved away from God. But really what had happened was he just had developed a normal life at that particular time. When he would go to a Christian convention, he wouldn't sit on the platform, even though he was always asked. He would be sitting out in the crowd, and an usher would come and get him, or somebody would see him, and they'd come and say, would you like to sit on the platform, trying to honor this great man. He died at 71 years of age, only preaching possibly 6 to 7 years of his entire life. The revival only lasted possibly 2.5 years before its decline. And this man who God chosen to be a carrier of a revival, can you imagine in less than a year, 100,000 Welshmen came to Christ because of what this man was flowing with and doing with God. That he released it into the country, his faith, and his heart was the door by which it began into a country. But yet, he died at 71 years of age. And some of the last entries in his journal and his diary stated this, that he didn't know, number one, why he was born. Can you imagine a young man that moved the nation of Wales, that today, where we sit in our time, in our generation, we admire this revival, we look for reports about this revival, people write me letters all the time, tell me more, where can I get more books about this particular move of God? But yet the man that led it, the man that God anointed to lead it, only preached possibly seven years of his entire life. And died not knowing why he was born. A Jezebelic spirit came and stole his confidence. A Jezebelic spirit came and stole his faith. Just like what happened to Elijah. He went into a cave, but God told him to get out. But Evan Roberts never came out of his cave. It's a sad story. The last entry in his journal was the word ill. And that's because he had got sick toward the end of his life. And he died at 1951 in his early 70s. A very sad story. What can we learn from him? Number one, God uses young people. But number two, young people need to have those who've gone before them to help stabilize them, help them know what to do so they don't make the misstep or align themselves with the wrong person. Three, the wrong alignment can cause great destruction to your life and to your ministry. Be with those who know the truth. Be with those who know how to live the right life, how to carry the anointed right, how to be the anointed one, and still have a good life behind closed doors. Another thing we can learn from Evan Roberts is that he did not know how to take care of his mental and physical man at the pressure of the revival. Always remember, even though you may be one of the leaders, it's really not all on your shoulders. It's on the shoulders of God. You may be the pivot man, the point man, but stand there and be there strong and let God use you, but realize you've still got to take care of yourself. Another thing is value the sacredness of your family and the intimate part of your home. Always, even if they're not saints, well, my relatives, they don't have the same Christian experience that I do. Yeah, but they're your family, and they love you unquestionably. And there's something about being in the sacredness and the intimacy of a family who loves you, who grew up with you, who raised you, who's concerned about you, that gives you a comfort to your soul and a comfort to your spirit. My friend, don't run to folks you don't know. Run to people you do know. Your spiritual family, number two, is important. Your spiritual home is very, very important to your life. Who you run with, my friend, spiritually will affect your whole life and ministry. Always learn to. Oral Roberts told me this one time I was having dinner with him. You can't mistreat his kids, or God will have to come and fix you. And I think Evan Roberts also began to take a little bit of a bite out of the people. He began to come against them in reactionary to the criticism. He was not taught how to handle criticism. I think if he went home, back to his home church, his blood family, and got some of the older men and great renowned men of that day who would have come at the beckoning call of Evan Roberts, who would have welcomed them and spent time with them, walked with them, because it was a revival that everybody knew about. It was noise abroad in England, Ireland, all over the nations of Wales. Even, to be able to tell you the truth, it was the beginning of what I believe God was trying to do at Azusa Street. He first tried to do at Wales. You have in the book of War on the Saints that Jesse Penlows and Evan Roberts wrote, he have the record of them coming against people speaking in tongues. I personally believe that this was the place where God wanted to restore the great baptism of the Holy Spirit. But because of these different things that happened and the attack of Jesse Penlows, that Jezebelic spirit, we lost it. But here's an interesting historical fact. The day he went off the scene and the day he removed himself permanently from the leadership and the main voice of the revival in Los Angeles, there was a man by the name of Frank Bartleman who had been writing to Evan Roberts, heard about the revival, writing to Evan Roberts saying, we want this revival in Los Angeles. We want this revival of God in Southern California. We've got to have this thing in America. What can we do to get the revival here? What can we do to get the move of God to come to California? And Evan Roberts kept writing back little things, prayer, different things he knew about the move of God, being yielded, repent of your sins, set your house in order. He was telling what he knew to help them. And this man would write out tracts. Frank Bartleman would pass them out and talk about the Welch Revival. And that it was coming to California. It was coming to America. Get ready. Get ready. And the day that the Reverend Roberts began to remove himself from the scene, the move of God jumped from the nation of Wales to the city of Los Angeles, the city that would become the great headquarters of the Pentecostal revival, the place where God sprung the Pentecostal message and the restoration of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the evidence of speaking in tongues, to a little mission called Azusa Street Mission. And I really believe, my friend, where really what God wanted to begin was in a young man by the name of Evan Roberts, who he touched all the days of his life. Evan never resisted God as a young man. He gave his life totally, never married, gave his whole life to prayer, the whole life to the ministry. Never did do much of what you call natural things. And God said, I can use this young man. He began to use him. See, it's not just a point to get God to use you. My friend, it's getting to how to stay in the using for a lifetime. How to stay in that flow for a lifetime. Not letting persecution, not letting personal troubles come over you. Not getting caught up in the public fanfare. Not getting caught up in all these things that seems to be the dominant thing today. The revival of Wales had no song leader. Had no advertisement. Had no great choirs, no special soloists, no famous preachers. It was a young coal miner who loved God, and God used him to come through his heart to bless people. When people came to him and wanted his autograph or wanted his attention, he said, don't look at me, I'm just a window. Look through me to see what God is doing, because God wants to do the same thing through you. You'll also learn in these great revivals that these great leaders said, I'm an ordinary person. You don't have to have a college degree. You don't have to have a seminary degree. You have to have the right heart and have the right counsel around about you. The right heart is the first requirement. Evan Roberts had the right heart, wanted only Jesus to be lifted up, people to be saved, for the nation to be touched, for the young people to come. As Evan Roberts disappeared from the scene, all those that tried to keep the revival going, the young singing ladies and the young preachers kept going, and many of them in the Welch Revival became some of the leaders in the Pentecostal movement that came to Great Britain from Los Angeles a few years later. I'm so happy that the Welch Revival is a part of our series here. I'm happy to tell you that you that are young, don't ever let anybody despise your youthfulness. God uses young people, and in the last days, His Spirit will come again over the young man, over the young woman, and they'll see visions again like Evan Roberts did, and they will prophesy and speak and proclaim the word of the Lord, and there will come probably thousands and thousands of young people and young men, just like Evan Roberts. We only had one in 1904, But in the end of this revival, we'll have thousands upon thousands. And I believe I'm speaking to some of you. Pay the price. Run the race. Don't give up on what you're going through right now. Do not let people's words or the difficulties or what you think God's will has seemed to be abated or aborted. Hold on there. Hold on to God. Go forward. Fight the devil. Have you realized that when you obey God, there is a war you have to be a part of? And that war first is for your obedience. If the devil can get you to stop obeying and start being defensive, he's already stopped the move of God in you. Christianity is built on offensive leaders, not defensive leaders. I've said many times to people, if you are a believer that is bored, it's because you live in a defensive realm of Christianity and not offensive. The Great Commission is an offensive commission. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Go take what I've given you to every person to listen. If they won't listen, well, just let them be and go to them that will listen. See, so many times people think if they're not honored by the latest famous person, if they're not honored on television or respected by this group or that group. But another great fact about revival, it's always amazing. The last move of God always persecutes the new move of God. I wish we could learn, and hopefully we'll learn from this series, how to enjoy the moves of God and not be anti them just because you weren't the one that God chose to lead it. I remember reading a book about a man that led a great move of God, and the people were looking at him to lead the next one. He said, I'm only called to lead one. I'll just participate in the next one. I thought that heart attitude was very good. He didn't have to be the number one leader. He was chosen to give a great lead for the one that just happened. A new one was starting. He said, I'll participate, but I'm not the leader. He was able to prefer the brethren whom God had chosen. So many times, especially in the American society, we are of the opinion, unless we think of it, unless we're the ones that lead it, it can't be of God. Do you know that God can do things beyond your sphere of influence? God can do things beyond your voice, beyond your ministry capabilities. And he may use people who you don't like, who you couldn't consider that God ever would use, because all the people we're looking at in this series are folks, when you look at their life, you'd say, why did God choose them? And I go back to one fundamental answer. Their heart was right. What their heart was. Their heart was right. You can have all types of problems, but their heart was right. And always remember this. You can also start wrong, but it's how you finish. It's what people remember. How you finish the race is important. When I read the story of Evan Roberts and how he ended his race, I actually have to tell you, the first time I read the story, I cried to the end of that book believing. And I just couldn't believe that Evan Roberts didn't preach as much as he did, didn't lead the revival. He ended early, premature. One historian said, well, he was only called to do that and his job was done. Well, let me challenge that. The call of God and the gift of God within you is for a lifetime. It's not just for 2 or 3 years. It's for an entire lifetime. I'm called to the day that I die. I may slow down because of my older years, but I'll never stop preaching. I'll never stop moving. I'm called and I'm positioned and I'm gifted by God for certain jobs in the church and in the world, and it's for a lifetime. These ideas that people come for a short season and disappear, that's not the truth. That's not the truth. You that are listening to me, some of you once preached, some of you once led great churches, led moves of God in these churches. Well, I command you, and I call for you to come back to your post, come out of your mental despair, and come back up to faith in God. Repent of your backslidden condition, and tell the devil to get off of your back, or get somebody that knows how to pray to begin to pray for you, and to break the power the devil has assigned against you, and come back where you belong. So we say, well, I'm divorced. Well, God uses divorced people. I don't know how many people write me when I tell these stories. How can God do this? God can do what he wants. I remember one time I was talking and teaching a certain lesson, and saying, this is the way it is. And God spoke and said, no, I can do what I want to do. He said, I can blend my gifts. I was teaching along the lines that if you're prophetic, you can't be a pastor. And the Lord said to me, I can blend my gifts however I want to. Don't you tell the people it can't work that way, because sure enough, I'm going to do it. And so we have to be careful that we have these hard, fast rules. If God can forgive the murderer, and God can forgive all these others, he can forgive those who've had problems in their married life and ended up in divorce and restore it. I'll just say this to you. Don't repeat that same thing again. Let God restore you. Let God put you back where you belong. Come up out of that thing. Stand strong. Obey the Spirit of God. Obey what God is telling you to do. This idea that people are calling for you to be silent, calling for you to go this way. Human people, human beings' opinions are always going to pull you to this way, want you to be quieter on this subject, want you to go that way. You have to take public opinion and push it aside. You have to let the fear of man disappear from you. One of the problems with Evan Roberts was he was scared of the public press and public criticism. If you're going to lead and have a great church or have a great move of God or whatever God's called you to do, there is going to be resistance. Every new level of anointing causes a new attack of the devil. Every new level of ministry causes people to get critical. Where does the criticism come from? People are jealous, number one. Number two, some folks were called to do what you are doing, and because you're doing it, makes them mad and makes them feel what they feel. That they've missed God. They've come under some type of other spirit and missed it. My friend, shake these things off. Come to where God wants you to be. And let the Spirit of God lift you up. Let the Spirit of God re-anoint you. Come back to your post. Stay in your rank. And let the young people, just like Evan Roberts, have a great revival, but don't make his mistakes. I pray today that you will obey the Spirit of God. And that you will do what God's called you to do. And never be afraid of any person or any devil or even God your Father. We want you every week to come back and be with us. We want you to know that we're here to bless you. We're here to help change you. We're here to help you make you an end-time warrior that's not afraid of anything, that's ready to invade everything and do what God's called us to do in these last days. Please, when you write, send your prayer request in. Also, you may want to know more information about the Bible school that we have in Southern California. So make sure you say, send me the Bible school information or look it up on the website and have all the information about it. Or if you're in Southern California, you're flying through Los Angeles, we're about an hour south of Los Angeles Airport in the city called Irvine. We'd love to have you on a Sunday morning or a Tuesday night, or you can just come any time of the week and come in and visit the Bible school and sit in some of the classes. Also, if you want more information about where I may be speaking, I may be in your area and you may not know it, so make sure you look it up on the website or when you're requesting the tape series here and the special offer with the book. Make sure you say, send me Robert's itinerary, or just call and we'll tell you where I'll be, and we'll hope to see you there. We hope to see you next week as well, too. Have a wonderful day.